Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Good day to you, my friend. Welcome to the broadcast today. What a delight to be with you. Thanks for joining us. My Bible's open. It's open to the book of the Revelation in chapter 19. That's almost to the end of the Bible, isn't it? Revelation 19. If you can, reach over, pick up your own copy of the Word of God and join me there. Revelation chapter 19. I'm going to begin to read at verse 6 here in just a moment. I've got a gospel tract I want to pass along to you, and I hope that if you've not done this before, that you will contact us, giving us your name and address, and allow us to send you a free sample packet containing one each of all of our English gospel tract. And a gospel tract is an evangelism tool. I hope during this Christmas season that you are using the fact that people are more alert to who Jesus is, why he came, that he came. I hope you're using it to give out the gospel in tract form or verbally telling somebody why Jesus came to earth in the first place. Well, I want to encourage you to get some tracts from us to help your witnessing, not just during the Christmas season, but all through the year. My announcer will give you some contact information here in just a minute, but let me lead in to our Bible study time this way. Now, friend, everybody loves a good wedding. Even we men do. Now, ladies, don't let us men fool you. A lot of men don't like the part where they have to get all dressed up for the wedding, but trust me, even men like good weddings. What we men particularly like at weddings is where the groom displays he's prepared. Recently, I saw a video of a wedding where a man was financially prepared to take care of his bride, and he spoke during the ceremony of his heart preparation. Most men, it's true, don't go in for a lot of mushy stuff, you know that, but we love seeing men who are men who lead, men who serve, men who display their readiness to take on responsibility. Us guys like those kind of guys. Now, today, we're going to attend a wedding. It's called the marriage of the Lamb, and obviously Jesus is the groom, and he's prepared. He's gone to prepare a place for his bride. If you are a child of God, you will be in the wedding. You'll be part of it. Oh, and one more thing. There's a pretty nice meal afterwards, so plan to stick around, won't you? Get your Bible and join me in the book of the Revelation chapter 19. I mentioned a gospel tract here a moment ago. That word tract is spelled T-R-A-C-T. Again, it's a short written presentation of God's plan of salvation. The one in my hand right now is entitled Two Kinds of Death. Two Kinds of Death. In this tract, there's a paragraph early on that says this: suppose we are before a casket in which lies the body of a dead man. He is physically dead. You, speaking to the one reading this, you are dead spiritually. He is separated from this world. You are separated from God. You say, I don't feel dead. Well, neither does the corpse. Your feelings have nothing to do with it. You don't have to feel dead to be dead. The corpse is dead, quote unquote, in the coffin. You are dead, quote unquote, in sins. You are a sinner by nature. Some are Irish by nature. Others are Swedish, French, or English by nature. But all men are sinners, children of wrath by nature. It is as natural for you and I to sin as it is for a fish to swim. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The tract goes on to explain how to get out of the sin predicament, the sin death hold, because Jesus Christ came and died on the cross, shed his blood, was buried, and rose again. Two kinds of death. Just one of the 41 or so tracts in the sample packet. My announcer, as I said, will give you our contact information. Use it to give us your name and mailing address. The sample packet from us is free. Let me give you, please, gospel tools to strengthen your outreach for the glory of God. You can go to our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. I told you how to spell tracts here a moment ago. With your Bible open to Revelation chapter 19, beginning of verse 6, here's what the Bible says. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. And he said unto me, Write, Blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, These are the true sayings of God. Stop, please, right there. In our series on prophecy, I've already dealt with the rapture of the church age saints, and then I took a few days to talk about the tribulation period, and I mean by that, that's the title for what happens on earth to those that are left behind after the rapture. But now I come to what's going on for the church age believers who have been raptured. I already, again, took some days to teach about what the Bible calls the judgment seat of Christ, and that's where the church saints are given their rewards for their service, or they can suffer loss due to lack of serving. Now, once these rewards, or these crowns as they're called, are distributed, a wedding takes place. Let me talk first of all about the when. When does this marriage take place? As I've been going through this prophecy series, I've tried to use the clearest and simplest Bible portions when dealing with the various prophecy topics. These verses here in Revelation 19 are probably, or absolutely have to be the best on the topic here, but they don't tell us all that we probably would like to know. Here in verse 7 of Revelation 19, the words that are found here, two words, are these, is come. The Lamb is come. Now, those words translate a Greek word that is in the past tense. Did you hear me? It's past tense. That means that by the time Revelation 19 happens, this wedding has already taken place. Now, since it could not happen until the bride was properly dressed, that's what's described there in verse 8, that means that this wedding had to have happened after the rapture. But before, it had to take place after the rapture, but it had to take place before the second coming of Jesus. That hasn't happened yet in the chronology here in the book of the Revelation. So that is the when. But let's now answer the where question. Where will it take place? There's really only two options, as you know. It either takes place in heaven or on earth. Well, the judgment seat of Christ happens in heaven, and the bride seems to return with Jesus at his second coming, according to verse 14 here. So I'm left to conclude that this marriage happens as well in heaven. All right, now we got to come to the question, who in the world is the bride? Who's the bride? There are some really good, godly teachers who are going to be at odds with me here, but frankly, it seems clear to me that the bride at the marriage of the Lamb is the New Testament church. This, then, would exclude the Old Testament saints, not that they're not worthy, but they're not part of the church. Now, let me give you some reasons why I think that the bride here is the New Testament church. These Bible facts form the foundation for my position. First of all, fact number one, the Old Testament saints, particularly those Jews, they are called Jehovah's wife. They're not called his bride. They're called his wife. They're already in a relationship with him. In the Old Testament, Israel is called an unfaithful wife. That's why during the church age, they have been set aside and God will come back to them. But they're not the bride. They're the unfaithful wife. Fact number two is this. The Old Testament saints are not given their resurrection bodies until Jesus returns at a second advent to set up his kingdom. If you're trying to take notes here, jot down these Bible references. These are the references that I think clearly indicate that the Old Testament saints, the Jewish saints, they are not going to be raised until the second coming. I base it upon Daniel chapter 12, verses 1, 2, and 3. That's Daniel 12, 1, 2, and 3. And also Isaiah 26, verses 19 to 21. There are some other ones, but those two I think are key. So, these Old Testament saints, they are not resurrected yet. They cannot be part of this bride in Revelation 19. A third fact is this. The New Testament church is referred to as the bride of Christ. She has been promised, she's been espoused to Christ as a chaste virgin. That's declared in 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 2. Then there's the famous passage on marriage in Ephesians 5, where Christ is preparing and washing and cleaning his church and referring to the church saints as his marriage partner. So here is one final note. Here in Revelation 19, verse 9, it says that there is a feast in honor of the bride and groom. Verse 9 says, "Blessed are they that are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb." Church-age saints with Christ in the heavens are going to celebrate while the tribulation is going on earth. The judgment seat of Christ is in heaven. The marriage is in heaven, so this marriage supper will then also be in heaven. It appears, taking our verses here from Revelation 19 and laying them alongside the parable of the 10 virgins, in the book of Matthew chapter 25, it appears that there's going to be actually two wedding feasts, one in heaven where the church is joined by the heavenly host in celebrating her wedding, but the other feast is going to be on earth at Jesus' return. The second one is where the church age saints and the believing people from Israel and the believers from all nations who get saved in the tribulation years, they're going to eat a great feast together in joy because Jesus, the groom, is present. Now, I'm not totally sure why God told us of the wedding feast in heaven, but I'm glad he did. If nothing else, it tells me that there really is a great joy in heaven. You know, the Bible says there's a great joy in heaven over one sinner that repents and gets saved. There's going to be great joy in heaven at this marriage and at the wedding feast. But you know what I delight in this passage? Verse 8 says this about the bride. This is going to include me. "And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints." Finally, my declared status because of Jesus, which is I have his righteousness. That's what I'm in right now. But frankly, day by day, I don't look all that righteous. But one day, I will be as righteous as Jesus is because I'll be arrayed in the righteous garments prepared for the church age saints. Do you know Christ as Savior, my friend? If you don't, you're not righteous and you can't get into heaven. Receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior from your personal sin. Receive him today.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888, and our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve him.